Good day. Today we are celebrating the 6th birthday of the largest saltwater ecosystem. Well, why don't we take a look at this jar, at the origins of this jar, how it was made, and how the ecosystem inside changed over the past few years.
So, almost 6 years ago, I took some water and seaweed, as well as sand, from the North Sea. As it turned out, a starfish came along with the seaweed and was already preying on a crustacean in the container. The ecosystem was assembled in this 10-liter jar. As we saw before, there was a starfish, and as it turned out, also a little crab came with the seaweed. A day later, I saw another little stowaway, a teeny tiny crab, about 2 millimeters big. There were also a few gammarids, as well as a bunch of tiny critters. A month later, this crab had grown quite a bit. The amount of small crustaceans and paramecia and other small critters have grown a lot as well. Most of the sea lettuce started to die at this point, possibly due to a lack of water movement. Some of the other algae, however, like this algae ball and this red algae, Gracilaria fermicillophila, had started growing. Like I said earlier, this tiny crab, which is probably a Leocarcinus arcuatus, has grown quite a bit. Or actually, it has grown a lot, because this individual is the same one as the really tiny one. The other crab actually died, unfortunately, shortly after the start of the experiment. This crab has been feeding on pretty much everything it could find, like algae, microbes, little crustaceans, and maybe even the dead crab. Look at how big it became in just a year. At this point, a mysterious tunnel appeared. Another month later, the red algae had grown even more, and the number of tiny critters had increased even more. Some new sea lettuce was starting to form on the glass, and the mysterious tunnel has now become two mysterious tunnels. They are the home of this spionid worm. It has two tentacles, which it uses to build a tube by grabbing sand and crushed shells with its tentacles and cementing them together with mucus, thereby building a protective home for itself. When the ecosphere was 4.5 months old, the Gracilaria fermicillophila was slowly spreading throughout the entire jar. The sea lettuce that didn't die quite early on seemed to be doing fine, and the newly formed pieces on the glass were slowly growing. The spionid worm caught a small crustacean. Our little 10-legged friend was doing marvelously. The king of the jar! Here, if you look closely, you can see a bit more of the worm's body, apart from just the tentacles. Still busy building that tube. There have always been some nematodes, the tiny white wiggly worms, in this ecosystem, but their population has really grown a lot after 4.5 months. Everything was going really well in this ecosystem. But then, when the jar was 5 months old, I returned from a holiday only to find the lifeless body of my crustaceous friend betwixt the algae in the glass encase rolled on my windowsill. 5 months earlier, it came into this ecosystem as a stowaway in some of the algae. It was only a millimeter or two in size and mostly swimming around, as it was still in the zoolarvae stage. Over the next few months, it ate, grew, and pooped non-stop, and made this jar its home, Until now. Because he's dead now. I'm still not sure why, but my hypothesis is that he died during a failed molt. Maybe because there was too little calcium in the system. A lack of food or oxygen, or too high a concentration of ammonia or nitrites seems less likely, as it was doing perfectly fine up until this point, and none of the other animals seemed to be affected. In any case, it was a major event in the history of this ecosystem, and I still miss him. Maybe it's a comforting thought that the large majority of crabs don't reach adulthood, but this one sure did. Just before the ecosystem turned a year old, there was a massive heat wave, killing most of the algae, resulting in the ecosphere looking like this a year after it was made. Luckily, the smaller animals and other organisms seem to have survived the heat wave, as well as the death of most algae. Which is remarkable, because less algae means less food and less oxygen, and a large increase in rotting organic matter, releasing all kinds of toxic compounds. A direct result, I think, from all those algae dying, is the emergence of cyanobacterial colonies, like the dark green patch in the middle of your screen. A bit further back, you can see two tentacles sticking out of the sand from, you guessed it, a spionid worm. It was interesting to see it again, because I hadn't seen it in 8 months. And then I saw two more. There were actually three spionid worms present in the jar after a year. The crab's body had been completely processed at this point, eaten by everything that wanted to eat it, and its shell dissolved. Even though most algae died during the heat wave, some of it was luckily still alive. An entire year later, when the ecosystem was 2 years old, most of the macroalgae had been decaying, and the entire surface of the substrate was covered in a carpet of mostly green string algae. There were large white paramecia and smaller red paramecia, little crustaceans, a marine tardigrade, and mysterious tentacles. Either the tentacles of a spionid worm or of a different organism. Or these could have been small worms. I don't really know. So, this is what the ecosphere looked like at the beginning, after a month, after 2 months, after 4 months, after 5 months, after a year, and after 2 years.
That was the last you saw of this jar, 4 years ago now. Oh my. Let's take a look at how it's doing now.
Well, this is what it looks like after almost 6 years. You'll notice that it doesn't look that different since the last update. The only difference being that the macroalgae has decayed a little bit more. 4 years ago, we saw that a carpet of green algae was forming, covering the sand. I'm not sure how well you can see it on the video, but nowadays there's also large patches with brownish-reddish string algae growing on top of the sand. At least, I think it's a brownish-reddish color, but I would like to remind you that I am colorblind, so take my color descriptions with a grain of salt. As you can see from all the bubbles in the carpet of algae, the algae are very productive. They've been growing and spreading over the past few years, of course, and are also producing loads of oxygen, hence the bubbles. There's also new algae growth forming on the glass. You might think that all the macroalgae is by now dead or dying, but that's actually not the case at all. All around the jar you can find these tiny green worm-like structures, which are actually new macroalgae growth. I'm not 100% sure which species, or even like 60% sure, but structurally it looks like Gracilaria vermiculophile. Here you can see another piece. I tried filming some of the copepods I saw swimming in the water column, but it was really difficult. I'm afraid this was the best I could do. This is so difficult to film, but you have to believe me. There are copepods in here. Please, believe me, you have to. Now, I was able to film some of the smaller critters that weren't living in the water column, but rather on structures like the sand, algae, and also the glass wall. Nonetheless, I'm going to go really fast and dismiss this ecosystem as nearly dead.
Whoa, not so fast. It's easy to dismiss the ecosystem as nearly dead, but I don't think that's fair. Why don't we, you know, take a bit of a closer look?
In order to take a bit of a closer look, I'm going to need lots of light, so why not use the sun? I want to take this opportunity to thank my patrons for their generous support, which allows me to buy the optics necessary for filming this, in this case a stereo microscope. This is my setup, the stereo microscope strapped to a bunch of books with string, suspended and pitched with beer coasters. This is what my dream job looks like. As soon as we do take a closer look, we see a world of activity right in front of our eyes. The little crustaceans on your screen are copepods in the order of Harpacticoidae, which are known for their short pair of first antennae. Most copepods, including most copepods you've seen in my videos, have a long first pair of antennae, sometimes longer than their body length. But as you can see, these guys indeed have short antennae. Fun fact about Harpacticoidae, some species in polar seas actually live in sea ice. Yes, inside of the ice. When sea ice forms, channels filled with very saline water also form, which remain liquid and are the home of bacteria, algae, annelids, and also Harpacticoid copepods. Pretty cool. Anyway, I'm drifting off. Harpacticoidae are classified as meiofauna, a term used to refer to animals that are too big to be called microfauna, but too small to be called macrofauna. And it makes sense. They are definitely visible with the naked eye, but too small to see any interesting details. These copepods are comparable in size to the many paramecia that live in this ecosystem, just a little bigger. But whereas the copepods are multicellular organisms consisting of many, many cells, paramecia are single-celled organisms. In the previous update, I already gave examples of differently sized cells, so I won't repeat myself, but isn't that crazy? So, let's take a look at these paramecia. Except, here comes the part where I tell you that I'm not so sure these are truly paramecium. Looking at their shape, and more specifically the shape and position of their oral pore, it looks a bit more like blepharisma, which, like paramecium, is a unicellular ciliate. But as I've said before, microbes aren't my strong suit, and I'm definitely not saying these for sure aren't paramecium, just that I'm not so sure what they are. Anyway, they are really abundant in this ecosystem, especially near and probably on and in the sediment. If you look closely at the glass, you can see that it is covered with way smaller microbes. The same is probably true for just about every surface in the jar. It's full of microbes. Here we see another critter that is seen less than the copepods and ciliates, but still often. I'm not so sure what it is. It looks like it might be a tiny crustacean, or maybe a mite. Either way, it's kinda cute. Taking a closer look really changes your views of a jar like this one. Instead of an empty, barren, dead jar, we see a luscious green jungle filled with life all over. Sometimes it's good to try to view things differently than you normally do. It might really change your perspective.
As you were able to see, this ecosystem is not dead. Far from it, in fact. If we take the time and effort to just look a little bit closer, we can see that this jar houses a vibrant community of different animals and organisms. All the organisms that we saw today have been living in this ecosystem for the past 6 years, and have comprised the ecosystem in the last 4 years. And it has been stable for the last 4 years. In fact, out of all the ecosystems I have, this jar has showed the least change, or is one of the jars that shows the least change in the last 4 years. The only thing that might have changed is that I didn't see any of the red paramecia, nor any of the tentacles I did see 4 years ago, but to be completely honest, I didn't really take the time to look that close. I'm ashamed to admit. The paramecia and the crustaceans and all the other tiny microbes that are just a little bit too small to see have been living in this ecosystem for generations upon generations, breeding and interacting with each other. I realized that these tiny critters might not be as appealing as, say, a crab or a starfish or even a spionid worm, but the fact that I have a stable ecosystem inside of this jar, stable for years now, is really exciting to me. It's hard to put into words. Well, I guess that's it for today, unless future me decides that he wants to add something. Bye.